Good day and welcome to Big Bad Tech. I'm Instructor Jim Pytel, and today's topic of discussion is the DC voltage divider rule. Our objective is to learn to apply the DC voltage divider rule to quickly and directly solve for voltage across individual elements in series DC circuits. This lecture operates under the presumption the viewers watch the series DC circuit properties lecture, available at the Big Bad Tech channel. If you haven't watched this lecture yet, or only dimly recall its contents, please take the time to do so now. As a preparatory exercise, consider these two series circuits. I invite you to solve for the voltage drop across each individual element in this system using the quickest and most direct means available. Again, I am interested only in the voltage drop across each element. While entertaining, I am not interested in total resistance, current, nor power. As fascinating as this information may be, all I want to know is the voltage drop across each individual element in these systems. By all means, pause the lecture and try this on your own. If you're tracking, you should have obtained the following results. Here's how I solve for these properties. You may have used different techniques in a different order. However, our answer should be the same. If you didn't obtain these exact same results, you are simply not qualified to continue. My sincere advice is to go away and don't come back until you've watched the Series DC Circuit Properties lectures like I asked. Feel free to return to this lecture when you've brought yourself up to speed. Assuming you're still with me, for the first circuit, the total resistance seen by the 12-volt source is 200 ohms plus 400 ohms, or 600 ohms. This implies the source would be none the wiser if the series combination of two resistors was swapped out and a single 600 ohm resistor took their place. This easier visualization can be used to simplify the analysis procedure. Making use of this simplification and application of Ohm's law demonstrates that the 12-volt source would push 20 milliamperes of current through this circuit. Current through elements in series is the same. I source equals I1 equals I2, and they all equal 20 milliamperes. Let's now examine individual voltage drops inside this series circuit. Given we know current through both elements to be 20 milliamperes, and we know the resistance of both elements, it's a simple matter of applying Ohm's law to each individual resistor. The voltage drop across R1 will be equal to the current through it times its resistance. V1 equals I1 times R1. Substituting in our given values for V1 demonstrates the voltage drop across R1 to be 4 volts. Similarly, the voltage drop across R2 will be equal to the current through it times its resistance. V2 equals I2 times R2. Substituting our given values demonstrates that V2 to be the remaining 8 volts. Before we move on to circuit 2, you'll note that the smaller 200 ohm resistor represents 1/3 of the total resistance and appears to be dropping 1/3 of the total voltage. Similarly, the larger 400 ohm resistor represents 2/3 of the total resistance and appears to be dropping 2/3 of the voltage. It's almost as if these series resistors are dividing voltage among themselves proportional to their resistance. We'll come back to this observation in a moment after we check our results for circuit 2. For circuit 2, we observe strangely similar results, although entirely different resistors are employed. The total resistance seen by the 12-volt source is 76 plus 152, or 228 ohms. This implies that the source would be none the wiser if the series combination of two resistors was swapped out and a single 228 ohm resistor took their place. This easier visualization can be used to simplify the analysis procedure. Making use of this simplification, an application of Ohm's law demonstrates that the 12-volt source would push roughly 52.6 milliamperes of current through this circuit. Current through elements in series is the same. I source equals I3 equals I4, and they all equal 52.6 milliamperes. Let's now examine individual voltage drops inside this series circuit. Given we know current through both elements to be roughly 52.6 milliamperes, and we know the resistance of both elements, it's a simple matter of applying Ohm's law to each individual resistor. The voltage drop across R3 will be equal to the current through it times its resistance. V3 equals I3 times R3. Substituting our given values demonstrates V3 to be 4 volts. Similarly, the voltage drop across R4 will be equal to the current through it times its resistance. V4 equals I4 times R4. Substituting in our given values demonstrates V4 to be the remaining 8 volts. As previously, you'll note that the smaller 76 ohm resistor represents 1/3 of the total resistance and appears to be dropping 1/3 of the total voltage. Similarly, the larger 152 ohm resistor represents 2/3 of the total resistance and appears to be dropping 2/3 of the total voltage. Again, it's almost as if these series resistors are dividing voltage among themselves proportional to their resistance. You'll note both these analysis scenarios necessitated we first solve for total resistance, then solve for current, then solve for voltage, our property of interest. If voltage is your property of interest, this method is a waste of time, and given the number of steps involved, is way too error-prone. Perhaps a quicker and more direct means of obtaining voltage across individual elements exists. This method is the voltage divider rule. As these preparatory exercises were meant to illustrate, voltage inside a series circuit divides proportional to resistance. The DC voltage divider rule is a simple proportionality equation that allows a user to quickly and directly solve for voltage across an element of interest without having to solve for total resistance nor current values. The DC voltage divider rule states that the voltage across the element of interest, Vx, is equal to the resistance of the element of interest, Rx, divided by resistance for that series path, R single prime, times the voltage across that path, V single prime. Note the ratio of Rx over R single prime must be calculated first, and then one would multiply the resultant proportion times the voltage across that path. Consider the DC voltage divider rule set up to solve for V1 in the first circuit. The voltage across the element of interest, V1, will be equal to the resistance of the element of interest, R1, divided by the resistance for that series path, in this case, R1 plus R2, times the voltage across that path. In this case, supply voltage E. Substituting in our given values, quickly and directly yields V1 to be 1/3 of 12 volts or 4 volts without the necessity of first determining total resistance nor current. A similar application of the voltage divider rule for V2 demonstrates V2 to be the remaining 2/3 of 12 volts or 8 volts, again without the time-consuming necessity of first determining total resistance nor current. Think about all that time you wasted on those unnecessary calculations. All that time could have been put to better use playing hacky sack and vaping in the parking lot with the rest of your class. Well, check it out. If you use the voltage divider rule, you'll have a lot more time to do those things and more because it allows you to quickly and directly solve for the voltage across individual elements without a lot of annoying busy work. In fact, it's one of my favorite techniques and you'll see me use it all the time. Now for the numbskulls among you, yes, I'm talking to you, I'm calling you a numbskull. When an instructor tells you something is his favorite technique, you can be damn sure the voltage divider rule is going to show up in every lecture, every worksheet, every lab, every quiz, every test, every kegger, and every clam bake from now on, and you better get good at it. Let's put the voltage divider rule to the test. Consider the series circuit of two elements. See if you can use the voltage divider rule to quickly and directly solve for voltage across each element in the system. By all means, pause the lecture and try this on your own. If you're tracking, you should have obtained the following results. The voltage divider rule set up to solve for V1 is equal to the resistance of the element of interest, in this case R1, divided by the resistance for that series path, in this case R1 plus R2, times the voltage across that path, in this case supply voltage E. Substituting in our given values, quickly and directly yields V1 to be 10.3 volts. Similarly, the DC voltage divider rule set up to solve for V2 is equal to the resistance of the element of interest, in this case R2, divided by resistance for that series path, in this case R1 plus R2, times the voltage across that path, in this case supply voltage E. Substituting in our given values, quickly and directly yields V2 to be the remaining 13.7 volts. There you have it. Two quick applications of the voltage divider rule yielded our desired results without any delay, toil, or tears. Given we save so much time using the voltage divider rule, we've got ample opportunities to check our work. There's two principal means of doing so, one via Kirchhoff's voltage law and the other via Ohm's law. Kirchhoff's voltage law states that for any closed loop, the sum of voltage rises will be equal to the sum of voltage drops. A Kirchhoff's voltage law analysis of this series circuit suggests that E equals V1 plus V2. Does the summation of voltage drops we obtained using the voltage divider rule equal the voltage rise induced by the source? 10.3 plus 13.7 does indeed equal 24 volts. Additionally, one can use Ohm's law to verify the results obtained using the voltage divider rule. Because these two elements are in series with one another, they should experience the same current. Ohm's law solving for current demonstrates R1 experiences 22 milliamperes. Similarly, Ohm's law solving for current demonstrates R2 also experiences 22 milliamperes. Current through these elements is in fact equal. This is to be expected given they are in series with one another. I've got a reasonable degree of confidence our answers are correct. All right, let's try another illustrated example of the voltage divider rule, this time featuring a series combination of three elements, and we're being asked to solve for the voltage drop across each element. Again, we're not being asked to solve for current, nor are we being asked to solve for resistance, nor are we being asked to solve for power. Our only mission is to swing the voltage divider rule over our head, charge into the jungle, and come back carrying three voltage values slung over our shoulder as quickly as possible. Note the general use voltage divider rule formula does not change despite the addition of more elements in series. The general use voltage divider rule formula states that the voltage across the element of interest, Vx, is equal to the resistance of that element of interest, Rx, divided by the resistance for that series path, R single prime, times the applied voltage for that path, V single prime. By all means, pause the lecture and try this on your own. If you're tracking, you should have obtained the following results. The voltage divider rule solving for V1 suggests that V1 equals R1 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3 times source voltage E. Substituting in our given values yields V1 to be 8.1 volts. Similarly, the voltage divider rule solving for V2 suggests that V2 equals R2 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3 times source voltage E. Substituting our given values yields V2 to be 15.3 volts. Finally, the voltage divider rule solving for V3 suggests that V3 equals R3 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3 times source voltage E. Substituting in our given values yields V3 to be the remaining 12.6 volts. As a means of checking our work, if we summate the individual voltage drops obtained using the voltage divider rule, they do indeed yield the 36-volt rise induced by the source. If this method seems too easy, an application of Ohm's law for any or all of the voltage values obtained using the voltage divider rule solving for current yields 22.5 milliamperes, thus confirming the most fundamental property of series circuits, notably current through elements in series is the same. I've got a reasonable degree of confidence that these answers are correct. All right, one more example of the voltage divider rule with a little twist. Now, I know I just handed you a shiny new tool and you want to use it to the exclusion of everything else, but quite like a warm bottle of Mad Dog 2020 Electric Melon goes well with a cold Taco Bell Chalupa Supreme, the voltage divider rule is well paired with other circuit analysis skills, notably Ohm's law and Kirchhoff's voltage law. Here's a challenge. I want you to solve for the voltage across all three elements in the circuit. However, you're only allowed to use the voltage divider rule once, and these two versions of Ohm's law one time each. That's it. I'm sending you off to battle with three bullets and your understanding of fundamental series circuit properties. Have fun. By all means, pause the lecture and try this on your own. If you're tracking, you should have obtained the following results. Since it's our newest, shiniest tool, let's make use of the voltage divider rule. The voltage divider rule solving for V1 suggests that V1 equals R1 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3 times source voltage E. Substituting our given values yields V1 to be 7.7 volts. We just fired the voltage divider rule bullet. In our belt remain two different versions of Ohm's law. Given we know voltage across a known resistor, let's use this version of Ohm's law. Current through R1 will be equal to the voltage across it divided by its resistance. I1 equals V1 divided by R1. Substituting our given values demonstrates I1 to be roughly 32.2 milliamperes. What has this knowledge gained us? Lots. We know R1 carries roughly 32.2 milliamperes of current. We also know by virtue of being in a series circuit, everything else in this system also carries 32.2 milliamperes of current. Again, current through elements in series is the same. I source equals I1, which equals I2, which equals I3, and they all equal 32.2 milliamperes. We fired both the voltage divider rule bullet and one Ohm's law bullet. Only one bullet left. We know current through known resistors. Pick one and hit it with our remaining Ohm's law. Let's solve for the voltage drop across R2. The voltage drop across R2 will be equal to the current through it times its resistance. V2 equals I2 times R2. We know R2 by virtue of being in a series circuit carries roughly 32.2 milliamperes of current, as does everything else in the system. Substituting in our given values demonstrates V2 to be roughly 26.4 volts. We have achieved two of our three stated goals, but we're out of ammo. What to do? Don't just give up yet. One more fundamental series circuit property lies within reach, notably Kirchhoff's voltage law, which states that for any closed loop, the sum of voltage rises will equal the sum of voltage drops. Our Kirchhoff's voltage law analysis of this series circuit suggests that E equals V1 plus V2 plus V3. We know source voltage, and we just calculated V1 and V2. An algebraic rearrangement of the Kirchhoff's voltage law equation for this circuit demonstrates that V3 equals E minus V1 minus V2. Substituting in our previously calculated values for V1 and V2 demonstrates that V3 is the remaining 13.9 volts. All three goals have been accomplished using three different methods, specifically the voltage divider rule, Ohm's law, and Kirchhoff's voltage law, and most importantly, your understanding of the most fundamental series DC circuit property, notably current through elements and series, is the same. You'll often see me use a mixture of techniques just to keep things fresh. However, if you prefer one technique over another, by all means get good at it and use it all the time. Importantly, regardless of the order or method employed, there is one right answer. You should get the same answer as your lab partner, and they should get the same answer as me. Actually, leave your lab partner out of that. I don't think they know what they're doing. Before we bring this lecture to a close, let's discuss a simple application of voltage division. Oftentimes, industrial systems necessitate operator or automatic input, specifying when to start or stop some action, or controlling how fast or slow that action occurs. Input can either be digital or analog in nature. A digital quantity, often called a discrete input, is a clear on or off signal that exists in one of two mutually exclusive states, true or false. Switches are associated with digital inputs, as a switch can be closed or open, and never a little bit of both or halfway in between. An analog quantity, in contrast, is a continuously variable signal. Sensors are often associated with analog input, as a sensor measures some quantity and outputs a voltage proportional to input. Analog inputs use different scales. For example, consider analog input ranging from 0 to 10 volts, where 0 volts represents a minimum value, 10 volts represents a maximum value, 2.5 volts would represent a quarter of maximum, 5 volts would represent half, 7.5 volts would represent 3/4 of maximum, and so on. A common method of controlling the stopping, starting, and running characteristics of a motor is with the use of a motor drive, a power electronics device that outputs AC voltage of variable magnitude and frequency, and thus the running characteristics of a motor under its direction. We'll examine the details of motor drives in much later lectures. However, a common method motor drives use to specify the speed of a motor is with the use of something called a remote speed potentiometer. If you recall, a potentiometer is a three-terminal variable resistor. They're typically configured in the following fashion, such that 10 volts DC appears across the fixed terminals A and C, and the voltage at the adjustable middle B terminal is the analog speed input to the motor drive. One can visualize a potentiometer as a pair of series resistors, RAB and RBC, where the total resistance from A to C is the full nameplate value of the potentiometer. If you increase RAB by 10 ohms, you decrease RBC by 10 ohms, and vice versa. Consider an application of 10 volts across the fixed terminals of a potentiometer by directly varying the physical position of the adjustable middle terminal. We are indirectly changing how voltage is divided among the two portions of the potentiometer. Consider a 5 kilo-ohm potentiometer adjusted such that half of 5 kilo-ohms, or 2.5 kilo-ohms, appears B to C. An application of the voltage divider rule demonstrates that VBC, our analog input to the motor drive, would be half of the applied 10 volts, or 5 volts. The motor drive would generate an output capable of driving the motor at half speed. Similarly, consider the same remote speed potentiometer adjusted such that 3/4 of 5 kilo-ohms, or 3.75 kilo-ohms, appears B to C. An application of the voltage divider rule demonstrates that VBC, our analog input, will be 3/4 of the applied 10 volts, or 7.5 volts. The motor drive would generate an output capable of driving the motor at 3/4 speed. You note in this application, current through the remote speed potentiometer never changes and is always fixed at a small 2 milliamperes, but rather as the operator adjusts the position of the potentiometer, voltage division between the two portions of the potentiometer does. If you're looking for more applications of the voltage divider rule, fear not. You'll find ample opportunities to practice this technique in the very near future. Until then, allow me to take a moment of time to issue a collective, oh really, to the numerous viewers that have taken time to comment in all caps, awash with spelling errors, about the utility and application of the voltage divider rule. A common complaint these fickle mushheads make about the voltage divider rule is my broad statement promising voltage values without the necessity of calculating total resistance or current. They're rather too quick to point out that the denominator, i.e. the bottom portion of the ratio, the summation of resistances for that series path under consideration, is the total resistance. This is true, but only for purely series circuits where one is considering the complete circuit. I am urging you to think beyond this limited perspective. Consider applications of the voltage divider rule for smaller series paths inside larger series parallel circuits. Consider a series parallel circuit consisting of four elements, R1, R2, R3, and R4. This is admittedly a more complicated circuit than we're used to. However, R2 and R3 are clearly in series with one another, any current traveling through R2 simply must travel through R3. R2 and R3 are clearly in series with one another. If one knew the voltage differential between nodes B and D to be, let's say, 10 volts, this would be a perfect setup for the voltage divider rule. The voltage across a series path is known, as are the resistances of those elements within the series path. Again, the general use voltage divider rule says absolutely nothing about total resistance for the larger series parallel circuit, but rather only the resistance of that series path and the voltage across that path under consideration. If we restrict our analyses to only this series path, an application of the voltage divider rule to solve for the voltage drop across R2 demonstrates V2 to be 2/5 of 10 volts or 4 volts. Similarly, an application of the voltage divider rule to solve for the voltage drop across R3 demonstrates V3 to be the remaining 3/5 of 10 volts or 6 volts. We will have ample opportunities to employ the voltage divider rule when we examine series parallel DC circuit analysis in later lectures. In conclusion, we learned to quickly and directly calculate voltage across individual elements in series configurations without the necessity of solving for total resistance nor current using the voltage divider rule. Additionally, we explored applications of voltage division, including analog inputs, and the use of the voltage divider rule outside of pure series circuits. Remember to review these concepts as often as you need to really drive it home. Imagine how well lab will go if you know what you're doing. Thank you very much for your attention and interest, and we'll see you again during the next lecture of our series. Remember to tell your lazy lab partner about this resource, and be sure to check out the Big Bad Tech channel for additional resources and updates.